Welcome to CNS Inspire series of interviews, featuring conversations with people who have made commendable contribution over the years for health and development justice. Each interview of CNS Inspire series explores what went well and not so well in the past 10-20 years, and how can we accelerate progress towards not only issue-specific goals and targets, but also for integrated development of all. This CNS Inspire episode features Dr. K.S. Sachdeva. With a very long and decorated evening in a major public tertiary hospital in National Capital Delhi to National TB Program of India, where he tided successfully through major challenges over time. To more recently with National AIDS Program in India, Dr. K.S. Sachdeva has had not only a very rich and diverse experience, but also has left indelible footprints behind. Presently, he is the Deputy Director General of National AIDS Control Program of Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Government of India, and responsible for Basic Services Division, Sexually Transmitted Infections Program, Donor Assistance Program, and Research for HIV. Diagnosing at least 90% of people who are estimated to have HIV, eliminating congenital syphilis, and eliminating parent-to-child transmission of HIV are some of the key goalposts he has set his eyes on. Without any further delay, let's listen to what he shares with us.
Through the simple managerial process of simplification of drugs and surgical consumable, the costs to the total health system came down by 40%. The shortage of drugs which we used to see within Delhi government dispensaries and hospitals actually became non-existent. In 2007, there were hardly any laboratories actually which could diagnose drug-resistant TB. So we started developing infrastructure for drug-resistant tuberculosis. Slowly and as of now, between 2007 and 16, in about less than 10 years now, the country has close to 650 molecular diagnostics, almost one in each district. They have 50 line probe assay laboratories, about 40 odd liquid culture laboratories, 50 odd solid culture laboratories, and the number of patients which of drug resistant TB which have now been put on treatment cumulatively till date is about 125,000.
Welcome, Dr. Sachdeva. When you look back to reflect, can you please share some of the actions that perhaps were game-changing ones and helped us be where we are today?
As I look back in my career, I started initially as a clinical doctor and worked in a tertiary level hospital for about 20 years. Where we used to treat patients their day-to-day problem on 1:1 basis. Then around the mid-career, I was entrusted with the few of the administrative responsibilities. Then with the Pulse Polio program kicking in, I was made to join the Pulse Polio program within the government of National Capital Territory of Delhi, and from there my so-called career with the public health started. At that time I was doing a mixture of both clinical duties as well as public health work. As the years passed by, I realized that the public health is equally challenging, equally difficult to implement on ground, as difficult as sometimes making a difficult diagnosis, and also as interesting and enthralling as clinical medicine can be. And what I also noticed is sometimes when you work at a policy level, you can actually deliver to masses good with your just one or two actions. So while you may struggle to treat thousands of patients in your clinical practice, but your one good policy decision at a administrative level or a public health level can save lakhs of lives. So that's the basic essential difference. So equally challenging, satisfying. So that's slowly and slowly my interest also started growing in this field, and through you can say a quirk of fate, we got pushed into more into administrative and the public health side rather than the clinical side. Initially missed clinical side a lot, but later on, as you have passed by, gained a lot of confidence in public health policy making and delivering things on ground. So as I look back, some of the great things which satisfied me most was one when we developed the essential drug list and essential list of surgical consumables for Government of Delhi, and then carried out procurement on them. And what we realized that through the simple managerial process of simplification of drugs and surgical consumable, the costs to the total health system came down by about 40%. So the one simple intervention brought down, and at that time I think the I'm talking about 15 years ago, so the costs of procurement must have been around 400-500 crores, which immediately saw a saving of more than 250 odd crores. Thus, you could extend those benefits to a lot more number of patients. The shortage of drugs which we used to see within Delhi government dispensaries and hospitals actually became non-existent with those, the essential drug program. Subsequently, I had moved to the National Ministry of Health and Family Welfare and joined the revised National TB Control Program. There also, when I joined, the program was only treating patients with drug-sensitive tuberculosis. The patients with drug-resistant tuberculosis were not attended at all. Then I started rolling out the program for drug-resistant tuberculosis way back in 2007. So in 2007, there were hardly any laboratories actually which could diagnose drug-resistant TB. So we started developing infrastructure for drug-resistant tuberculosis slowly, and as of now, between 2007 and 16, in about less than 10 years now, the country has close to 650 molecular diagnostics, almost one in each district. They have 50 line probe assay laboratories, about 40 odd liquid culture laboratories, 50 odd solid culture laboratories, and the number of patients which of drug resistant TB which have now been put on treatment cumulatively till date is about 125,000. So have we not started rolling out this program and expanded in a way, almost an exponential way, which we did that, we wouldn't have been able to actually address the difficulties and challenges of this patient. And through our treatment alone, I think we must have saved more than 60,000-70,000 lives of these patients, made their quality of life much easier, their suffering to their whole family much lesser. Similarly, I also look back and see the challenge of TB and the HIV coordination. So initially, only those patients who had a high risk behavior within TB were offered an HIV testing. And then again in 2007-8, we said no, the coordination should be a holistic one, when we started offering HIV diagnostics to all TB patients in 2007-8. And in 14-15, through our own operational research, we noted that even those people who are suspected to have TB or are symptomatic for TB, if you screen them for HIV, they also give you a very good yield of HIV, thus yielding a very early diagnosis. And that's when we introduced the policy of provider-initiated testing and counseling of TB suspects and TB patients for HIV. And the yield through this PITC is close to 2%, one of the very high yield compared to any of the key population groups within the HIV subpopulation. Thus, and if you look at the percentage contribution in new HIV case detection, so from the TB patients and TB suspects is the highest contribution in new HIV detection, which we are contributing now. So again, we, as I look back, we have been able to make a significant impact in the lives of people who had HIV, diagnosed them early, offered them an early treatment. And as you know, today, people with HIV now live much longer, 20 years, 30 years, and we, as opposed to the popular notion that they would die within a few years of being diagnosed. So these things are very satisfying, and they uplift your moral spirits also.
Thank you, Dr. Sachdeva, for sharing what went well. Were there some challenges or things we could have done differently in the past years?
There are a lot of scopes of improvement in many areas of life where we work. Within the TB program also, we realized that an equal number of patients are seeking treatment outside of the national programs, or those who approach the private sector. So we began initiatives to involve private sector on scale, so that we can reach to all patients. And few of these initiatives were standardizing treatment options, which are common to both public sector and private sector. And thus, we developed an enabling document called Standards of TB Care in India, which talks of common standards across public and private sector. This also helped us to some extent to gain confidence of private sector. We also then tried to make TB notification mandatory for everybody. It's not truly mandatory, because it's still an executive order, and the practitioners are encouraged to notify TB patients, so that programs have a better sense of the load within the community and they can address this thing. So as I look back, what I realized that we had not been very aggressive in involvement of private sector on scale, and which we aspire that in future we would be more aggressive. So that's one area where I think in future we need to lay more emphasis on, more stress on involvement of private sector in TB program. And the same holds true within the HIV program also. Even in today's meeting, I'm relatively new in the field of HIV per se. So on my informal interaction with the manufacturers of antiretroviral drugs, I try to get an idea of how many patients may be there who are not within the national fold. Interacted with 5 or 6 drug manufacturers, got an idea of how much is their annual sales, and what I noted is that it roughly translates into about, say, 100,000 patients of HIV who do not seek care within the national program. They, for their own reasons, valid reasons, they do not wish to visit the government facilities, or they do not want to be recognized as suffering from HIV, and other confidentiality issues, they seek treatment within the private sector. But this is there, which means there are a lot of patients who, if we can make the or processes which enable patients to seek care in confidence, and they can repose faith in their providers that they will be they will not share their status with the anybody else, which is a national policy, but somehow that confidence within the patients is lacking. So if we can enforce that confidence, probably we can get more patients on board, provide them treatment free of cost, and also offer them a good quality services and other advice. So this is one area I think where we would be keen to know involve, not only engage with patients but also engage with their provider, so that patient may choose to then stay with their designated chosen private providers, but we get to know of how the patients are faring and how can we actually link our services with those patients.
Thanks for sharing your reflections from the past decades. Dr. Sachdeva, now looking forward, please share some of the top actions we should be taking to accelerate the pace of progress.
One of the few top things which we should be doing now is that we should be now developing models of care which are more community oriented, which are more public health oriented, and get all stakeholders on board. So while all those national programs are working, they are trying to involve stakeholders, but still they are seen more or less working within their own silos, and it's actually the confidence of stakeholders beyond the national program is less within the national government, and we should be bridging that gap. Also involving more and more community members to take care of their own health, demystifying some of the treatment options for complex diseases, building the capacity of health personnel to address these public health issues. So these remain some of the foremost things which we should be doing. Also, we should now look to leverage resources beyond the ministries of health. So there are a lot of opportunities available to leverage on resources from the corporate social responsibility. There are corporate philanthropists which are available. There are many individual donors which are available. The national governments and the programs have not actually systematically tapped onto those resources, but there is already a thinking going on that we should be actually having a common platform and tapping onto those resources, and also look at HR beyond what is available within the national health system. All the qualified professional which are available with the country should be able to contribute towards a disease-free India. So that's where we should be working on this.
It has been a long journey, Dr. Sachdeva. Challenging though, but your work has made a significant difference, we believe. May we ask you to please share some of the moments that make you proud?
Moments which make me proud are one when we introduced rational use of drugs within the government of National Capital Territory of Delhi, and way it has been scaled up beyond and we have even left the programs, they are still sustainable and rolling. So that's one moment. As you look back, it makes you proud. Similarly, the when I look at the drug resistant TB control program in the country, I mean, India puts in the diagnosis and puts on treatment the largest, highest number of patients compared to anywhere in the world. And we have treatment outcomes comparable to the rest of the world. So that also, and then the way we introduced newer drugs, the pharmacovigilance and other newer initiatives within the program, when we reflect, it's a good feeling, but still a lot of work to do.
Thank you. Before we wrap up this conversation, Dr. Sachdeva, please share some key messages for those who are at the early stages of their journey in public health related work.
One of the message which I would wish to give them, that this is a very challenging, exciting area, very satisfying area, but it's not that the rewards will come instantaneously. Here the rewards of your hard work come down a few years after you have put in hard work, as opposed to a clinical practice where you see a patient, treat a patient, you may see rewards of your hard work coming within days or maybe weeks or months. Here you may have to work for years to see the rewards of your attempts, but the rewards which you should see here are actually disproportionate to the effort which you put in. I mean, your one policy level change can change the entire spectrum and life of the communities. It can save thousands and lakhs of lives. It can improve quality of life of lakhs and crores of patients. So it's a very satisfying, challenging area, but needs a lot of dedication, patience, perseverance to see the results of your efforts.
We were listening to Dr. K.S. Sachdeva, Deputy Director General of National AIDS Control Program of Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Government of India. He's responsible for Basic Services Division, Sexually Transmitted Infections Program, Donor Assistance Program, and Research for HIV, among others. This podcast episode is part of CNS Inspire series of interviews featuring conversations with people who have made commendable contribution over the years for health and development justice. Each interview of CNS Inspire series explores what went well and not so well in the past 10 to 20 years and how can we accelerate progress towards not only issue-specific goals and targets but also for integrated development of all. For more details, be welcome to check our website at www.citizen-news.org. Thanks for listening and stay tuned for our next episode of CNS Inspire series next Tuesday. Goodbye.